Good morning, Life Center family. I just want to bring you a word of encouragement today that the Lord has been speaking to me about through this time, and it's based on some conversations I've been having with some of you. And it's very current. It's very relevant to what we're all going through. At this point, I think it's starting to feel like 2020 will never end, and like there's just chaos everywhere, right? I don't believe that. I believe 2020 will end at the end of December, and that chaos itself will also be brought to resolution. But in the meantime, we're here. This is where we are, and we're going through it. There have been some amazing testimonies in our congregation of businesses that have thrived surprisingly through all of this, and of healings, and of people gaining hope and traction and all of that. And then there have been other testimonies. We've heard stories where people have had great loss, have been through the ringer, have had significant decline in business, all those things, right? So we're all going through this, but we're going through it very differently. Everybody's having these unique experiences of these times. But all of us are fully immersed. I don't think any of us are just having sort of an average day these days. And it makes me think of the importance of being present, of refusing to be scarred by what we go through, but by accepting the mark of what we go through. So there are a number of examples that I thought of that I could bring to you today biblically. I think what I'll use is just Peter's life, the Apostle Peter. Peter was probably 15 years old when Jesus called him. So he was like between maybe 18 and 20, maybe 21 when Jesus died, right? And it was at some point in that process, he began to realize that he was being marked by what he was going through with Jesus. And we can see the shift, right? So we have that Peter's like the most fun to make fun of. Everybody loves to make fun of him because he's sort of petulant, and he's spontaneous is maybe the most positive take you could put on it. Maybe he's just out of control. He's got this real big personality, and he's definitely not bowling with the bumpers up, right? So he's constantly all over the place. And you see Jesus in one breath go, hey, whoa, do you even know what spirit you're of? How could you do that? You're way off. And then in the other breath say, yeah, I think I'll build my church on that, right? Jesus wasn't shaken by what he saw in Peter that shook others, right? It's the Jesus who said, get behind me, Satan, who then said, feed my lambs, who restored Peter. And then we see these epistles that Peter wrote that are probably some of the most confrontational epistles that are present in the New Testament at all. As technical as Paul was, Peter was that confrontational. And he writes these like, whoa, really instructive, really almost corrective, like you could just live out of 1st and 2nd Peter. It was those personality traits in 15, 16, 17-year-old out of control Peter that Jesus recognized and stewarded into this man who would become one of the foundations of the church that we all now live in. All right. So if Peter had been through the things that he went through, but had not been marked by them, had not been present, had not been changed, we wouldn't have the church that we have today, the way we have it, right? We wouldn't have the restored Peter. We wouldn't have the apostle who wrote the epistles, who became a foundation, who was a pillar. We wouldn't have what we have today. He went through remarkable times. He wasn't having any average kind of run-of-the-mill days either. And in the midst of it, we see Jesus lift his gaze over and over again. And he transitions from somebody who would have probably been hurt, right? If we imagine him sitting by the lake and Jesus saying, Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? We see pain, right? We see shame, we see regret, we see that he is being scarred by the things that he went through. But Jesus converts his heart, and the sum total of those times comes out as a mark. It changes him, but not as a scar. He's not limping. And it's a perspective thing. It's a perspective thing, and only Jesus could do it, right? Peter couldn't have just bucked up and sort of pulled himself up by his bootstraps and just done better. It's not that kind of thing. It had to be Jesus. It had to be supernatural. It had to be sovereign. And so my prayer for us today, the thing that the Lord keeps bringing up in me, both in conversations with other individuals and just internally, is that these are times that are difficult. They're complex. They're not simple. They're not easy to navigate. And it doesn't do any good to oversimplify them or to exaggerate some sort of false sense of hope. Our hope is in Jesus in these times. And if we're perpetually pursuing proximity, that's a lot of P's in one. If we're really going after just staying near Jesus, right? When it says that the other disciples were, in John, I think 21, it says that the other disciples were afraid to acknowledge Jesus when he invited them over for breakfast by the lake, right before he has this conversation with Peter, but Peter went to him, right? He was willing to close the gap, even though he was ashamed, even though he was feeling all the pressure of what was going on around him, even though he was in over his head, right? He was willing to close the gap, and it led to his restoration. If we are willing again and again and again and again through these times to look to Jesus, to turn our eyes to Jesus, to close the gap, to pursue nearness, then out of these times we will come as victors, as people who are restored, as people who are marked by the times. We do want to be changed by what we're going through. We want to be present. But we can do it without being scarred. We can do it without being scarred. It can turn us into the kind of powerhouse. All these silly things that we came in this with, we can leave with strengths. But it's going to take proximity. It's going to take staying close to Jesus. So that's my prayer for you. That's my prayer for myself as we move forward. So I'm going to pray that and leave it before you as a blessing for today. So Jesus, I ask that you would grace us, that you would grace us with the ability to overcome whatever trepidation may be present in our hearts because of what we're going through, that you would allow us to have single-mindedness, that we'd be focused, that we would turn our attention again and again and again to you through this, and that we wouldn't refuse the mark of the moment that we're in, but that we'd allow ourselves to be discipled, to be stewarded, to be changed, that we'd allow you to take these idiosyncrasies, these weaknesses, these personality deformities, and to turn them into these gracious strengths upon which you prophetically can see outcomes that are beyond even what we could hope for. We want to be changed by what we're going through. So we ask you to allow us to lift our gaze. Grace us to see you. Grace us to draw near. Grace us to come and to sit and to hear what you have to say and to receive the challenge to feed your lambs, to be restored. Be present. Be so proximate. Be near. Manifest yourselves to each one of us in the everyday, in this building, of course, but then throughout our weekdays, throughout our job, throughout the time with our families, throughout the good news and the bad news, all that stuff. Would you so keenly attune our hearts to your nearness that we can't miss? In Jesus' name, bless you guys. This is going to be a season that we'll look back on and we'll say, that's when I became the thing that was needed. We're going to be grateful for this in hindsight. Bless you guys. Love you.